Praise the Lord, saints. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? I just want to read something that I read today, and it kind of lit me up all day. It's in Micah 7:15. It says, "Who is a God like unto thee that pardoneth iniquities and passes by transgressions of the remnant of his heritage? He restraineth not his anger forever, because he delighteth in mercy." That's our God. No one else can take away the transgressions that you have before him but him. He's a good God to us. And that's why we're here tonight, that we might learn more about him. Because you can never learn too much about God, because he's a big God, a great big God, and he's our God. Would you stand with me? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's get our mind on him. Let's just ask him to bless this Bible study. Lord, we come to you because you're the only wise God, the only one who is able to deliver, the only one who is able to help. Lord, we ask you tonight that you would bless the speaker, Lord, that you would bless your word, that it would go in our heart, that it would plant seed, that we might grow thereof. Lord, and we will give you the praise and the honor, for no one else deserves it but you. And Lord, we just lift you up in Jesus' name. Amen. You may have your seats.
Amen. Well, praise the Lord. God is so good. God is so good. It's good to see you out tonight for another night of Bible study. How many were here last week? Last week's Bible study. Well, we're going to get into some things tonight. In fact, I think tonight the passages that we're going to look at tonight, they are my favorites in this book because there's so much being said in so few little verses. You know, one of the things that we need to understand when we're reading our Bible is that these are not fairy tales. As incredible as some of the things sound, they're not fairy tales. This is the Word of God, and he's given us insights into things that have happened in the past, as well as things that are happening in the future. And it's not until we get a grip on that fact that the Word of God is infallible, that it's unchangeable, and that it is absolute truth, every jot and every tittle, no matter how incredible it is, it's at that point that we really begin to move forward with our faith. In fact, I look at the Bible no more. I don't think of it as just the promises of God. They are absolute statements of fact that cannot be voided out. And there's many men that want to get rid of the Bible and throw it out and say it's an archaic old book that we don't need anymore, a book of antiquity. But to me, it is the bread from heaven. It is the living bread. And so we're here tonight to find out, what did God say in his word? The more that we can understand the word of God, the more we can understand the ways of God. And so we're going to pick up where we left off last week. We've entitled the Bible study, Contending for the Faith, because to maintain the faith and to hold on to your faith, it has always been contention. There has always been the powers of darkness that try to strip the Word of God from us, to strip the faith of Jesus Christ away from us, and so there is a contention. As a matter of fact, I started right in the middle of a different book. Let's start with verse 1 and just read down. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God the Father and preserved in Jesus Christ and called, mercy unto you and peace and love be multiplied. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and to exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. For there are certain men, here's why you need to earnestly contend, because there are certain men crept in unawares who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. I will therefore put you into remembrance, though you once knew this, how the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not. And let's just stop right there. Jude is saying, in a nutshell, we only covered four verses last week, but he's saying that he felt a compulsion, an unction from the Holy Spirit to write and to warn the Christians of that day
that they needed to earnestly fight, to contend, to agonize, to hold on to the faith. Because there were certain men that had crept into the church. And you'll remember from last week we explained that these men came into the church under the cover of stealth. They came in expressing themselves outwardly as though they were a Christian, but inwardly they were not a Christian at all. In fact, they had their own motives for even taking the position that they did. Paul would tell us in 2 Corinthians, he would warn us about the same thing. He says, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, who transform themselves into the apostles of Christ, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. He's telling us that this is a common practice of the powers of darkness. Jesus would say the same thing. He'd say, beware of false prophets. They come in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravening wolves, meaning that there is an outward expression of Christianity, but inwardly the reality of Christianity was not there. And this is what's causing Jude to write this letter, to tell us that there are men that have crept into the church unawares. You know, right now Christianity gets a bad rap. It really does. It gets a bad rap because you have men that are out there that they just want to make money. They just want to, they see it as lucrative, and they just want to make money off of Christianity. Then you also, Christianity gets a bad rap because you have people that are truly born again that have just never matured, but somehow they bought a microphone. And so they're spewing all of their Christian ignorance all over the place, and even a spirit that's not a Christian spirit, and it gives Christianity a bad name. But just as men have crept in long ago in the days of Jude, even in today's society, we have men that have crept into the church. And now it's even more dangerous because they bring along with them all of their thoughts that are external to the Bible. We have men making multiple millions of dollars, infusing things into the church that is simply not in the Bible. But they're very deceptive because they've learned to use Bible terminology to fool us. Moses went on a 40-day fast. Jesus went on a 40-day fast. And so we'll present 40 days of purpose. And if you don't really have a discerning spirit, you won't know there's nothing magic about the number 40. Are you with me tonight?
Yes.
And so this is a common marketing plan where people come in and they learn how Christians operate, and then they come in looking like a Christian, talking like a Christian, but yet they're not a Christian, and their motives are not Christian. I was thinking earlier tonight, if I was a news reporter and I wanted to go and I wanted to do a expose on the homosexual lifestyle, and I needed to find out all the inner workings of this lifestyle so that I could report on it, what would you do if you were that reporter? First of all, you'd buy some homosexual clothes that make you appear to be a homosexual. And then you'd learn the slang that homosexual community uses for their different acts. You'd learn all the language of homosexuality. You'd get maybe a homosexual haircut. That's what you would do if you were trying to get inside. And then you would make a few homosexual friends to give you credibility. Oh, yeah, I know Bobby. I know whoever. And you put on all the externals, but internally you're trying to reveal something. And that's what happens in Christianity. People put on the externals, but yet they are by stealth moving in to the body of Christ for their own purpose. Satan moves really in three different modes and three different categories. He has a lot of tricks. He uses a lot of different tricks. But there are three major modes through which he uses. First, of course, he comes like a roaring lion. The roaring lion, he is just devouring. There can be no mistake that is Satan. If you think about the meth problem that we have in this nation coming up from Mexico, where people's lives are being totally devastated by methamphetamine or cocaine or heroin or whatever the drug is, You can look at that poor brother or sister that's addicted to some substance and their life has been ravaged. They've lost everything. Their health is failing. And you see the roaring lion effect of the powers of darkness on that person. That's obvious. You can just look at that and all the warning signs go up. Danger, danger, danger. Have you ever heard a lion actually roar in the wilderness or in the zoo? If you hear the animal roar, you don't even have to see the animal. You know, I don't want any of that. I don't even want to be around that. And that's how when Satan is operating as a roaring lion, you can easily look at it and you can determine, yeah, I don't want anything to do with this. And he's able to damage a lot of lives. He's able to hurt and ruin a lot of lives in that way. The second mode in which he operates is that of a subtle serpent. Now, this is it's not as open and it's not as outward, but it's more dangerous than the roaring lion. If you see what meth does to a person, you just go, oh. Take my wife, for example. Her older sister, one of her older sisters, when they were in high school, was addicted to heroin. And she got off of heroin cold turkey. My wife saw what happens to a person going through heroin withdrawals. And she has never done drugs in her life because of that. She saw the impact and effect of the roaring lion, and she said, I don't want anything to do with that. So Satan would advance to his second means, which is the subtlety of a serpent. A serpent can be right close to you, and you don't realize there's danger. If you hear the roar of the lion, the alarms go off. There's danger. That's not a good thing. But if you hear, you can walk right up on the serpent, and you not even know it's there. I was doing some work in the yard. I've got some big stones in my yard, and I was moving them. And somewhere, thank God, as a little boy, they taught me that if you pick up a stone, I always pull it to you in case there's a snake under it. It can't jump on you. I picked up the rock and pulled it to me, and there was a snake. I didn't realize I was in danger. And that's what the serpent, when Satan moves as a serpent, sometimes you don't discern that there's danger there, but at some point in time, it becomes very obvious. The third and last mode, major mode that he moves in, and it is the single most dangerous. It is when he moves as an angel of light. He transforms himself as a minister of righteousness. Because there are no alarms that go off. There is no obvious danger. He's put on the outward expression of a Christian or even a minister. No warning bells go off. You don't know that you're in trouble until you're in Waco and the place is burning down around your head. Until they're passing out the Kool-Aid with the Jim Jones affair. That's when you realize, oops, I've made a mistake. And so we as Christians have to get in the mindset that we are earnestly contending for the faith. And once you grab a hold of the faith of Jesus Christ, what it is, you will easily be able to discern whether that preacher is preaching Jesus Christ or not. If he's not preaching the blood, what is he preaching? If he's not preaching Calvary, the price that was paid for the remission of our sin, based on that foundation, what is he presenting to you? And we've gotten into a time that we've allowed ministers to come in with just religious talk. Just religious talk. And we pay them. And we give them tithe. And we give them offerings. When they're not really feeding the flock, they're just speaking religiously. And men have become masters at knowing how to milk the crowd because they'll fluctuate their voice. They'll emphasize certain things. They'll sing a little bit. And get everybody all emotionally charged, and the money's flowing, but there's no scriptural knowledge that's being impacted within the congregation's heart and life. So we have to have a mindset that we are going to earnestly, meaning honestly, contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. Verse 5 of the first chapter of Jude. He says, based on all of that we talked about last week and today, I will therefore put you in remembrance, though you once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not. Now, Jude is saying that because there is a compulsion in him to warn the people to earnestly contend for the faith, he says, I'm going to put you in the remembrance. I'm going to bring some things back to your remembrance that you have already known, but it seems as though you have forgotten it. And we have the same problem in America today. In modern Christianity, there are things that at one time was just common. Everybody knew it. There was no question about it. 60 years ago, there was no question whatsoever that you cannot have a happy homosexual lifestyle. We seem to have forgotten it. The Supreme Court seems to have forgotten it. And now there are actually Christians that are vacillating between, is it right? Is it wrong? Is it right? Is it wrong? And so Jude had to put them in remembrance. Let me give you some Bible examples of just how wrong that it is. He's going to give three examples here, three remembrances. First is, and it's in this scripture, is Israel's unbelief, how they operated in unbelief. They did not contend for the faith. They let go of faith altogether and began to operate in unbelief and what God's reaction was to that. He's then going to bring to their remembrance the impact of the fallen angels, the angels that left their first estate. And we'll talk about that for a few moments. And then finally, the impact on Sodom and Gomorrah when they, in open rebellion to God's laws, went their own way and did their own thing. And all three of these instances, there was a severe judgment that fell upon these principles. And there is a severe judgment that will fall upon the false apostle, the false minister, those who crept in by stealth to persuade God's people to go a wrong direction. If you bring into God's church the spirit of Jezebel, which she was the woman who seduced God's people into worshiping idols, there is a severe judgment that comes upon the minister. We are the apple of the Lord's eye. And when you touch us, you have just angered the living God. We're encircled people. And so let's look at some of these judgments. Here's the first one. How that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterwards destroyed them that believed not. Now, you'll remember from the Egyptian Exodus that God, with a mighty hand, he sent Pharaoh to Moses to stand before Pharaoh some seven times, and each time he did it with miracles that were just astounding. And the Hebrews in Egyptian bondage, they're watching this. They're watching the whole thing, and they're seeing the miracles, God's mighty hand at work. And finally, the last time that God sent Moses to Pharaoh, he told the Hebrews, I want you to hit the lintels of your doorposts with blood, the blood of the Lamb, typifying Christ. And it was just a few hours later that all of them were marching out, some 3 million strong. They were marching out, and not only did the Pharaoh say, you can go, take some gold and silver and take some stuff with you. They loaded them up. So when the people left Egypt, and then even as they left Egypt, the Pharaoh tried to follow them, and God opened the Red Sea. And they walked across on dry land and then looked back and God shut the sea on Pharaoh and his horsemen. They saw the miracles. They were operating in faith. But then as they got into the wilderness, then as things were not quite the way they wanted them to be, the wilderness is equivalent to you and our sanctification process. They began to murmur and complain. And even though God was raining down manna every day, except Sabbath, even though he was providing water for them out of a rock and for all of their cattle and all of their livestock, they begin to operate in unbelief. And here's what it says. Having saved the people, afterwards destroyed them. The same God who saved them from Egyptian bondage is the same God who afterwards allowed their carcasses to fall dead in the wilderness. You see, when we don't contend for the faith, when we just get wishy-washy, well, you know, I can take it or leave it, I can believe it or not believe it, or I believe this piece, I don't believe that piece, you are angering your God. And these, you cannot, there's no way that you can say that the Hebrews were not God's people, because God, he told Moses, go tell them, let my people go. These were not sinners. He said, go let my people go. And so he saved them, God saved them out of Egyptian bondage, but then the same God destroyed them in the wilderness. Now, we have in modern times a doctrine called unconditional eternal security. Once saved, always saved. Saying that once you get saved, there's no way you can be lost. You can do whatever you want to do. But that's not what this scripture says. This scripture says God saved the people and afterwards destroyed them. Now understand something. You are eternally secure, but it's not unconditional. You have to continue to maintain faith in Jesus Christ and the price that he paid for you, which is not hard. It's very simple. No matter what wilderness that you pass through, you have to maintain that faith. Jesus died for me. And if you do that, then your eternity is secure. But don't let anyone ever tell you that, don't worry, now that you're saved, just get after some sin. Now that you're saved, everything's good. Sin more than you've ever sinned because grace abounds. When they tell you that, tell them, no, God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? And don't let them tell you. And this is the main scripture you can use to defeat the doctrine of unconditional eternal security. The same God that saved them is the same God that destroyed them. So we see then from this scripture, and this is what Jude is doing, he's bringing this to their remembrance. Look at your Bible, look what's written in the Word of God, and see for yourself how important maintaining faith in your God really is. The second example, he says, and the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness until the judgment of the great day. Now, we have to cobble our understanding of what happened with the angelic host together from the scriptures that we have. God did not give us a clear history of the fall of the angels or even the creation of the angels. There are scriptures that are in the Bible that give us a glimpse here and there. But we need to remember the Bible is not a book of explanation. God is not trying to explain anything to us. It is a book of revelation. And he is revealing his redemption plan for the human race. He's not really dealing directly with the fall of the angels, although it has an indirect impact. He's not dealing with that, and so he hasn't given us detailed information on it. He snatches the scripture here and there, give us a sense of what happened. So he says, the angels which kept not their first estate but left their habitation. We know from the book of Genesis that the angels, well, let me say this before I say that. The angels were all created at the same time. Every angel, the myriad and myriad, billions and billions, they all have the same birthday. God spoke the word and created all of them at the same time. He created them in different ranks. There are ranks of angels, seraphim, cherubs, and archangels, and different ranks of angels. He created just like he did for Adam before he created the Adams. No doubt, he created a place for the angels, the spiritual world. That's where the angels abide. That's where they're supposed to be. But the angels, at some point, and for some reason that we're not real clear on, they left their first estate. They kept not their first estate and left their own habitation. There was a place that God put the angels. This is your domain. And yet, for some reason, they left their first estate, and they came to this earth, and they began to cohabit with women and produce offspring as well. Now, let's turn to the book of Genesis, and we'll look at the scripture that we do have that does tell us somewhat what happened. Genesis chapter 6. It says, and it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God referred to the angelic host, just as it does in the book of Job, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit does not always strive with man, He also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. Now, there were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that. When the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, and the same became mighty men of old, men of renown. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart were only evil continually, and it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping things and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And I'm looking for another passage, and I'm just not seeing it here, but I'll just quote it. The scripture says, it's not right there, but it is in Genesis, that Noah was perfect in his generations. And when you look that up in the Hebrew and begin to look at the original language, it means that his pedigree was pure. His bloodline, his family line had not been impacted by these angels coming down and mingling with men and women, that he had a pure pedigree. But the point that I wish to make is that the angels came down, began to cohabitate with women and take wives, and they produced this breed, this hybrid breed of half man, half angel. They are referred to in the Hebrew as the Nephilim. That's the name. They are giants. According to some estimates, back in Genesis, they were upwards of 30 feet tall. They would consume so much food that you couldn't even feed them. That's all the, you know, everybody would be a slave to them because they ate so much food. Goliath was a descendant of the Nephilim. He had four brothers. All of them were giants, six fingers, six toes. All of them were descendants of this hybrid race, because although the flood wiped them out, it did not completely eliminate them, because it says they were giants after those days. Anyway, this is the impact and the effect of these angels coming down, leaving their habitation and copulating with women. Now, here's the problem. Angels are a different creation than us. When God created mankind, he created animals, and he created the whole animal kingdom, but he put barriers between men and animals. The creation model does not allow for there to be a crossover between men and animals. Are you with me? The same is true, and it's just as gross of a mindset to cross between men and angels. It defies God's creation model. And so as a result of these angels coming down, they received the judgment of God. He hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. In fact, he has put them in the bottomless pit. These fallen angels, he destroyed the offspring, but the fallen angels he put into the bottomless pit under chains of darkness. They remain there to this very day. And they will be released at the great white throne judgment, at which time, along with mankind, all evil is judged and done away with. Now, the point that I wish to make is that when you defy God's creation model, when you cross the barriers that he has put in place, that presents some severe problems, and it brings the judgment of God upon the person that's doing so. Then the third point, verse 7, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Now, he brought up the situation with the angels to lead into what happened at Sodom and Gomorrah. Notice the word, even as and in like manner. He just said the angels left their first habitation, came down, copulated with women, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities round about them, in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication. The word fornication, we generally think of it as sexual relationship between two people that are not married, and that is fornication. But the definition is even wider than that. Fornication is any type of sexual perversion. And a woman copulating with an angelic being, that's fornication, because it defies God's creation model. A man copulating with another man, that defies God's creation model. It is sexual perversion. It is fornication. And he's bringing it up to show, of course, one of the major sins of Sodom and Gomorrah was, of course, sodomy. And he's saying the angels were judged because of crossing over God's lines in terms of sexual expression, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities round about them in like manner gave themselves over to sexual perversion and going after strange flesh. Is everyone with me tonight? Let me slow down. There were actually five cities in the plain that God destroyed by fire. It was Sodom and Gomorrah. Those are the ones that we usually speak of, but Adma, Zeboim, and Zoar, all of those were destroyed, and homosexuality was not the only sin in these cities. They were depraved, wicked people. There may have been some bestiality going on. There was certainly all type of violence, and you'll remember that when God came to Abraham, he had two angels with him. And the Lord stayed there and spoke with Abraham and Sarah for a while, and he sent the two angels to Sodom and Gomorrah to get Lot out. And these cities were so wicked, they wanted to rape these angels. Read your Bibles. And Lot was about to give his daughters up to protect the visitors that he had, but that's pretty wicked. I mean, that's pretty vile. And I'll share this with you. It's just thoughts that come into my mind. What if God had went with the angels to Sodom and Gomorrah? Would these men have wanted to rape God? I mean, that's as wicked as you can't get any more defiled than that. That's totally depraved. It says that all five of the cities were destroyed. They were giving themselves over to fornication. Again, fornication is sexual perversion, something that defies God's intended use of the sexual expression. And let me just stick on that word for a minute, because we live in a time that we're so jaded that we don't realize that all sex outside of marriage is the same as homosexual sex. I said all sex that's outside of marriage is just as much fornication as homosexual sex. It is just as vulgar in the mind of God. The Bible said marriage is honorable, and the bed is undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers, he said, I'm going to judge you. God gave the crowning, he gave the crown of sexual expression only to those who are legally married one to another, one man and one woman for one lifetime. That he gave the sexual expression within that. If you enjoy the sexual expression anywhere outside of marriage, you fall in this category. Boy, that's strange teaching, isn't it? Because you don't hear this anymore. Now it's anything goes. What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. But no, it don't. It's going to come back up. You're going to give account of that. In like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh. Now, this term strange flesh, it speaks of a flesh of another kind, not ordained by God. In other words, when the angels came down and copulated with women, they were going after strange flesh. They were going after another kind of flesh from their self, another kind of creation from themselves, which was not ordained of God. It's just like if a man, and again, this is somewhat vulgar, copulated with an animal, well, that's strange flesh. God didn't ordain that. You've crossed the line into an area you shouldn't be in. And when man copulates with another man, that is strange flesh. A woman with another woman, that is strange flesh. You're seeking something that's outside of the boundaries that God has established for human sexual expression. Am I making sense?
Yes.
Okay. And are set for, now when you do this, When you fall into this category and are set forth as an example of suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Now, I don't know how long the situation went on there in Sodom and Gomorrah. I mean, I don't know how bad it was. But I know that when it ended abruptly. I mean, it ended permanently. When I was in the Navy, they had a place in the Philippines called Subic Bay. Subic Bay, Olongapo City, was the heart. It was the most wicked place, and you know, we sailors, well, we were sailors. Anyway, it was a wicked place. Probably 98% of the female population were active professional prostitutes. There was nothing. There were the main streets were three floors high. All of them were bars, just alcohol and sex. It was just a wicked, wicked place. So wicked that a jaded sailor might, like myself, I could look at it and go, man, this is just not right. Something's wrong with this. Well, after I got out of the Navy and I left, God allowed a volcano to go off in Subic Bay, and it put that whole place under 50 foot of ash. There is no more Subic Bay. There is no more Longapo City. It's gone. It's over. And so when God's judgment does fall, it falls in a very real way, as it did the five cities in the plains with Sodom and Gomorrah. And so now, Jude is bringing up these examples of God's judgment, that his judgment is true, that it will fall, that it will happen. Although God is long-suffering, when his judgment falls, it falls very, very severely. Likewise, also, these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. Now, let's not lose our train of thought of what the book is talking about. He started by telling us about men that had came into the church under the cover of stealth. They came in privily, and they began to preach nefarious doctrines. They began to rob the people of the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so then he branched off and says, now when you operate outside of what God has ordained, that judgment is going to fall. And he gives the example of Israel. He gives the example of the fallen angels. He gives the example of Sodom and Gomorrah. Then he says, likewise, going back to the main thought of the false preachers, likewise, these filthy dreamers, they defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignity, of dignities. Meaning that there are many ministers out there that have no reverence, no fear of God whatsoever. I mean, they're just, it's like they're not even saved. They're natural thinking. There's no spirituality there. And you need to, as Christians, understand that if you come into contact with a minister that does not fear God or that does not preach the blood of Jesus Christ as the heart of all he does, you need to get away from there. You need to run from there as fast as you can and find a preacher that's preaching the Bible. And as we go forward in time, Bible preaching, as it has up until now, is going to get less and less and less. The prophet Amos prophesied that people would run to and fro seeking a word, and there would be a famine in the land, a famine for the hearing of the words of God. And we live in that time right now that you can go to 10 churches and maybe one of them is preaching the Bible. And it's probably not going to be one of your major denominations. And we have now where you have major ministries, national ministries, even global ministries that have perfected religious talk without feeding the flock God's word and just raking in millions of dollars, hands over fist. And sometimes we as Christians, we need help to connect the dots. We see it, but we don't really know what we're looking at. The gentleman down in Houston, Texas, he packs out, I don't know, between 20 and 30,000 people every week in his sanctuary. It's a coliseum of some type. He preaches zero gospel, none. Now, his daddy was a preacher, a real preacher. He came up in the church, but he was never impacted by Christ. And now he finds himself in this position, and he's making money hand over fist, but he's leading 20 to 30,000 people straight to hell. Lives are being broken. Careers are being ruined. People are being destroyed. Marriages are falling apart because the truth of the matter is that if you don't have the direction book, if you don't have the user's manual, you can't get it right by accident. And listen, when people are hurting, just smile. Just smile a little bit. That doesn't help people when they're addicted to chemicals. And we have this all over the place now. In fact, the Holy Spirit thinks so little of this that he called these men and women filthy dreamers. The phrase means that they come up with what they minister out of their own mind and not out of the Scripture. They just come up with stuff out of their own fertile minds, and we have this, it is commonplace now. It's commonplace. It happens all the time. I want to read just a couple of things, and I'm going to mention some names here, and I'm not trying to embarrass anybody. I think that when you make a public statement and you continue to make them over and over, the public needs to be made aware that that wasn't right. What you just heard wasn't right. And so these are quotations from different television programs that these ministers have been on, or different sermons or books that they've written or preached. This quote is by Kenneth Copeland. He says, "It wasn't the physical death on the cross that paid the price for sin. Anybody could do that. Every prophet that walked the face of the earth under the Abrahamic covenant could have paid the price for sin." Now that's as wrong as two left shoes. You just can't be more wrong than that. That comes from his work entitled From the Cross to the Throne. Here's another quote by the same gentleman. "I was shocked when I found out who the biggest failure in the Bible actually is. The biggest one is God. I mean, he lost his top-ranking, most anointed angel, his first man ever created, his first woman ever created, the whole earth and the fullness therein, and a third of the angels. That's a big loser." And that was his comments on the national television program TBN in April of 1988. Filthy dreamers. That you won't find that in the Bible. Benny Hinn, TBN, December of 1990. He, speaking of Jesus, who is righteous by choice, said, "The only way I can stop sin is by me becoming sin. I can't just stop it by letting it touch me. I and it must become one. Hear this. He who is the nature of God became the nature of Satan when he became sin." Now, if you don't know your Bible, it sounds religious. And I know that when he made this statement, there were people in the audience going, "Oh, yes. Oh, amen." Not realizing the man is so filthy dreamer. And I don't say that to denigrate the man's program. I don't even know him. He might be a nice brother. But what he is preaching comes out of his own mind. It is not coming out of the Bible. And that, saints, that's why you need to earnestly contend for the faith. You need to learn your Bible. You know, if you never saw a $1,000 bill, and they do have $1,000 bills, if you never saw one, and somebody said, "Here's a $1,000 bill," but you don't know if it is or not, you'd have to test it. You'd want to take it until somebody proved to you, man, that's monopoly money. You would think you had a $1,000 bill. Well, if you don't know the gospel for yourself, if you don't understand God's redemption plan and what the Bible is, somebody can give you anything and you can't discern the difference because you don't know. And so this is why Jude is saying, earnestly contend for the faith. Every one of us should have a deep Bible study. We should know this book. We should, if you're not well acquainted with this book, you need to just get into the New Testament and just read the whole thing three times. Just read it from Matthew through Revelation. Just read it. You won't understand most of it, but you'll at least have been exposed to it. And then go back into the Old Testament and start looking at how the foundation was laid. There are some people that read this book once all the way through every year. They read it every year all the way through. That's a lot of reading. Now, I'll give you that. That's a lot of reading, but it's a good practice. But definitely, you should spend hours in this book getting to know it. Something that my wife and I did when we first got saved, and I don't know if it was the Lord or not, or we just were looking for a way to get educated. We began playing, back in those days, they didn't have CDs. They just had cassette players. And so we bought the Bible on cassette. And we'd have an auto-reverse that just plays all night long. And we turn it on when we went to bed, and we just play it all night long and wake up in the morning. And sometimes at night you can have a dream. When I started preaching, I would have dreams at night. Man, I would be preaching like a madman. I mean, I would be quoting the scripture just perfectly, and I'd wake up at night, and I'm just listening to the thing. But that's been now 26 years. We've listened to the Word of God every night. We listen to Romans maybe two or three months, and then we'll change it to another book. and we just listen to it every single night for 26 years. Now, that doesn't make you understand what you're hearing, but it makes you know what you're hearing. And you can quote that scripture wrong, and I'll know immediately you just quoted that wrong. Sometimes I can quote it wrong, and I realize, wait a minute, I messed up. That wasn't the right scripture. And it's the same concept of, remember one of the songs that you listened to before you got saved. And if you heard that melody again, those words would just come right out. You know those words, even though it's been decades ago. And the Word of God is the same way. The point that I'm trying to make is that learn to earnestly contend for the faith. Learn to really apply yourself. God has given you an intellect. He's given you the ability to think. Put it in the Bible. Don't try to disprove the Bible. You just make a fool of yourself. Look at the Word of God in reality. Look at the prophecies alone. And you'll find that where we are right now is where prophets said we were going to be 2,000, sometimes even 3,000 years ago. Here we are right now. In the last days, there will be scoffers. Well, here we are. We got a nation of scoffers. In the last days, people would heap to themselves preachers having itching ears, meaning get preachers that preach what we want. Well, here we are right now. The people would no longer be able to stand the true word of God. Here we are right now. So just based on that, nobody's smart enough to write it 2,000 years ago and hit it right the nail right on the head tonight. Only God, the Holy Ghost, can do that. So we have to learn to earnestly contend for the faith. Here's a real good example of filthy dreamers. This was a quote by Marilyn Hickey. This comes from the Christian Centennial in December of 99. And it's a little bit long, but I'll just read through it so you can get a sense of what a filthy dreamer is. Her latest mailing received by the Christian Centennial in January 99 focused directly on poor widows and women struggling with financial troubles. She mailed us 2 pennies stuck to the return card of an envelope to join her in her prayer tunnel. The 2 pennies represented the 2 coins the poor widow woman put in the temple offering in the 21st chapter of Luke. The appeal reads in part, "This is what I want you to do. Take your personal prayer sheet, place the palm of your right hand over the 2 copper pennies. We are going to use them as a miracle point of contact together. Now, write down today's date in the box marked today. Be specific and write in the miracle amount of money that you would need. Write down any other personal areas of lack and need for which you are desperately desiring a miracle and want me to release my faith for you. Finally, search your heart and write a check. Whatever you give, make it the best gift to him that you possibly can." Then the appeal concludes, "Here's what we're going to do. First, I'm instructing every one of my prayer warriors who come in contact with your prayer request sheet to make sure that they touch it, lay their hands on it, touch the same 2 coins that you've touched. Next, we're going to form a prayer tunnel of financial faith for you. It's a powerful thing. I'm believing as your request sheet passes through my prayer tunnel of faith, you'll pass through your dark tunnel of financial pressure. I really want you to hear my heart. This is a very serious matter, and we're not playing games with the devil. This is war. Like the little widow, sow a seed out of your need." Now, saints, if I ever come in here and tell you about a prayer tunnel, you need to find another church because I have severely backslid. The point that I'm trying to make is that men and women, we see this on national television programs, the Christian programming all the time, is that people come out of their own mind with things. They don't come out of the Word of God, but yet they're able to propagate it because Christians don't know the Word of God. I saw a man, it's been a couple years ago, he had, I don't know, it was one of the Jewish feasts were coming up, trumpets or something like that. He had 7 big pots, like those plant pots back there on the stage. And, of course, the numbers are ticking. You know, people call in. Here's how many people are on the phone right now. Here's how much money we already took. And the numbers are just scrolling. They're just going. And the man is making his appeal for people to send in funds, whatever your financial need. God's going to give it tenfold. And each time that we break one of these 7 pots with a hammer, we bust it, God is going to escalate the financial blessings that are going out. And one by one, he broke each of those 7 pots. And the money wheel was just rolling. It was just going, people on the back, on the phone. Saints, none of that's in the Word of God. None of it's in the Word of God. You don't, God is not a slot machine where you give him money and he gives you something back. I don't need more money. I need more health. I need more life. I need my baby to have more health. You know, the money I got now, I can live this fine. What I'm doing now, this is fine. This will work for me from now on. But what I need is for more of Jesus in my life. I need a closer walk with him. And he says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. He said, I just give you the junk. It's all temporal anyway. You're not taking none of it with you. But we're to seek him first. And I know in my own life, my wife, the two of us together, we have always put God first no matter what the cost was, no matter how scary. And sometimes God will press you right up to the wall. He'll check you. And no matter how scary it was, we've always looked at each other and said, well, baby, we ain't got nothing now. We might as well just go ahead and go with God on this. And God has blessed our lives abundantly. And so don't let men come in and just shear you like sheep and take your wool and give you nothing spiritual in return. These are filthy dreamers. They defile the flesh. They despise dominions, meaning that anyone who has a true word from God, any spiritual authority, they will despise them. And you know, I'm going to say this, and I usually don't say these kind of things. That's one of the reasons Brother Swaggart is so hated right now. Because he'll call you. He'll check you on it. And, you know, I mean, I may not do it the way that he does it. I may not prefer that way. But that brother will stand up and tell you what the truth is, no matter what the cost is, no matter what the personal cost is. And the ex-attorney general who just got out of office, he's a, I can't think of his name, but he is a minister in the Assemblies of God. I can't think of his name, but he just made a statement that churches and men of God need to stop worrying about their tax exemption and come forth with a prophetic word because this whole nation's going under. I mean, morally, we are very close to Sodom and Gomorrah morally. We just took a couple major steps into darkness this morning with the Supreme Court, the defeat of the Defense of Marriage Act. All of those are going to move us in a wrong direction. And I told Sister Lincoln, as soon as I heard it, you know, we have our policy for doing weddings on the website. We don't do weddings for anybody that's not a longstanding, active member of this church from today forward. So, because they're going to come straight to Christianity and they're going to try to label us as hate mongers and get us in trouble with the government if we don't accept them. That's the next step. It's coming right now. And so we put our policy up. You're going to have to sit under weeks and weeks and weeks of doctrine. I don't think they can do it because it's going to get pretty tight. But everything is taking a step to evil. They despise dominion and speak evil of dignities. Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but saith, the Lord rebuke thee. But these, speaking of the filthy dreamers, speaking of those men who are not of God, but these speak evil of those things which they not, but what they know naturally as brute beasts, in those things they corrupt themselves. Now he's given an example of Michael, of course, is the archangel. He is the protector of Israel. He's one of God's main angels. And Lucifer, who his name is now Satan, he in eternity past his name was Lucifer. The name means light bearer. He was one of the most high-ranking angels in God that God had. But for whatever reason, he fell from his position that he had. But yet when Michael contended with him about the body of Moses, Michael an angel, Lucifer a fallen angel, yet Michael durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke you. Meaning that this great angel, Michael, who is still a holy angel, is speaking to a fallen angel of darkness, but yet respects him and the rank that he used to hold. So you have a Michael up here speaking to Satan down here respectfully. At the same time, you have a filthy dreamer down here, a thrice holy God up here speaking disrespectfully. Do you see what he's trying to show? And we especially, Lord help me, we have ministers right now across this nation. It's gone on since the baptism of the Holy Spirit fell decades ago, who absolutely blaspheme the Holy Spirit when it comes to the baptism, who absolutely become so jaded and so harsh that they speak with a venom and when you blaspheme, you can get forgiven for homosexuality. God will forgive you for that. But the blaspheming of the Holy Ghost, there is no forgiveness in this world or in the world to come, because they are speaking evil of a dignity so high that it's incomprehensible. The Holy Ghost is God. And so we have to be very careful, because now, like no other time in society, the things of God, they get no respect. You know, back in the 40s and 50s, you could take some of the holiness women would like walk down the street and they know their holiness. And men would take their hats off and bow their heads and treat them. They were afraid of holiness folks. It ain't that way no more. But you know what? Holiness folks ain't holiness folks no more either. Because now they look at us and we're wearing what they're wearing. And we look like they look. And their music is our music. And their world is our world. And we just saw them in Vegas last weekend. They was in the lottery line right ahead of us. We talked together in the lottery line. And so we've lost our power because we have intermingled with the heathen. Come out from amongst them, my people, and separate yourself. Touch not the unclean thing. And God said, I'll receive you if my people that are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then would I hear from heaven and I'd heal this whole homosexual business. Well, I can feel the preacher coming. I've run out of time. We're going to stop there and we're going to pick up right in verse 9, 10, 11 on next week. I would ask you, go home and read these passages that we've looked at tonight. Run some of the references. If you have a reference Bible, run some of the references. If you have a commentary, read some of the comments that ministers have made concerning these scriptures, but you need a good commentary. Albert Barnes is a good one. Brother Swagger's got some good commentaries. John MacArthur, he's got some pretty good stuff. As long as you don't deal with the Holy Ghost, he's got some very solid information. And so get all that you can get while you're thinking about these concepts. Amen? Amen? Praise the Lord. We're going to ask Brother Jasper, would you come, please, and receive our offering for this evening?
Praise ye the Lord. Now that was old school, wasn't it? I'm going to ask the ushers, would you please come down?